Good morning, Harvest. Good morning. Guys, a little quiet this morning. The 9 o'clock was like rocking. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Mike Ruge, and I serve as one of the pastors here, and it's my privilege to bring God's word today. And we're going to continue on with our summer series, Unsung, Everyday People. And the name of the message is Reconciling Faith. And as it pertains to reconciling faith in everyday people, I thought of a person who's very near and dear to my heart. His name is Trevor James. He actually attends this church here. He was at the 9 o'clock service, and there's a picture of him and I there. I don't have a little brother, so I sort of like adopted him as my little brother, and you can see in the picture he is smaller than me, and he hates when I say that. But he's very near and dear to my heart, and as a bigger brother, I'm so proud of him. This man cannot shut up about Jesus Christ. He cannot stop sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with boldness. And you know, I love how he always ties things back into the gospel. We could be having ice cream, and he looks at the vanilla ice cream, he's like, you know, that reminds me how God loves us and saved us. And I'm like, what are you talking? That's all right. But he always ties it back to the gospel somehow because he has a heart for the Lord. But see, here's the thing about Trevor. He wasn't always like that. We all have some BC days, right, that we're not very proud of. And there's some pictures of Trevor in his BC days. Yeah, I don't know whether to laugh or just get sick. This guy is the kind of guy that fathers look at and say, keep my daughter away from him. In fact, we should probably keep all daughters away from this guy here. But see, those were his BC days. He was quite reckless. And I got his permission to share his past with you. Because here's who Trevor was. He was an adulterer. He committed adultery against his wife that led to divorce. The man that you see there was a liar. He was a deceiver, a manipulator. He was an addict and all those things and more. But here's the thing that Trevor did. He humbled himself. He got low because he knew he needed to be saved. He knew he needed to be redeemed and reconciled to God because of his lifestyle. So 3 years ago, he gave his life to Christ, repenting of his sins and turning and becoming a new creation because the gospel had changed his life. But here's the thing about Trevor's past. People still view him as his past, and it's unfair. People are judging him for his past, but that's not who he is anymore. He's a new creation, and God does not see the sin upon him anymore, and henceforth he's been redeemed. But someone from his past is not willing to let it go. It's his ex, unforgiving. She's very hurt. What do hurt people do? Hurt people hurt people. She's gone as far as calling the police on him, calling DCFS on him. They have two kids, by the way. All unfair. I read the report. So unlandish, so outrageous of reports that are false because of his past. And she's doing everything she can to diminish his reputation. But what she doesn't know is that he's been reconciled with God and he is no longer like that. I wonder how many of you have felt judged for your past. Or perhaps you've judged others for their past. And that's what's going on here in the passage. And as Trevor is defeated, he can't speak on his behalf because there's actually a restraining order against him. So he can't make things right. He can't offer reconciliation. But only God could advocate for him. He needs some help in that regard because he can't do anything upon himself because he's being judged for his past. And again, going back to the Acts chapter 9, verse 26 through 31, we're going to see here that Saul was judged for his past. So Saul had already been on his way to Damascus when Jesus Christ met with him, struck him down, but raised him up, made him a new creation, and therefore then going and proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ with boldness in Damascus. But only the Jews, like, you know what, I'm tired of hearing this from you. We feel betrayed by you. What's this message that you're bringing us? And so they plotted to kill him. They plot it. So this isn't some of those like threats like, hey, I'm going to kill you, man. No, this is like legit. They're going to kill him. So what does he do? Like anybody else, he would flee, right? So he went to Jerusalem to find refuge, to find safety, but only he was only rejected there as well because they judged him for his past. Which brings me to my first point. So if you have your Bibles, please turn to Acts chapter 9, verse 26. Reconciling faith believes that God works in others no matter their past. But before we get into God's word, let's take our time to pray. Father, we give you thanks for this morning. We're asking that you would soften our hearts and you would open our minds to the good news that you have for us this morning. I'm praying, Lord, that we would leave here changed, transformed, and if anyone doesn't hear and who knows you yet, they would be humbling themselves before you, and they would receive your Son, Jesus Christ, as their Lord, repenting and coming to faith in you. So we give this time to you. We love you, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So again, reconciling faith believes that God works in others no matter their past. So let's start here in verse 26. And when he came, hold on a second. Who's the he here? There's a pronoun. Who is the he? Well, the he is Saul. Now, hold on, Mike. Didn't he get converted already? Didn't he go from Saul to Paul? Can I just clear that up for our church once and for all? It's the same guy. His name did not get changed. Nowhere do we find in Acts chapter 9 that Jesus actually changed his name. But somehow we got on this thing of, you know, the Saul of old, Saul of Tarsus, the persecutor and the murderer. And then he got changed, he got transformed, he's been redeemed. So now we're going to call him Paul. But I just want to set the record straight that it's the same guy. So Saul is his Hebrew name. But Paul is his Koine language. That's his name in the old Greek language. In fact, Saul is mentioned 11 times after his conversion. So there is no, he was Saul, and now he's Paul. You guys get that? Can I move on by calling him Saul? So it's not Saul of old, but it's still the same guy. So let's continue on in that verse. Verse 26, it says here, and when he had come to Jerusalem, which by the way, that's his first time in Jerusalem as a disciple, when he came to Jerusalem, he attempted to join the disciples. Now imagine this. As I mentioned, Saul, they're seeking to kill him in Damascus. So he flees. Let's go to verse 24. Let's jump up a bit. Verse 24, I'm going to give a little bit more context here. It says this, but their plot, so their plot is the Jews, their plot became known to Saul. So Saul found out that they were watching the gates day and night in order to kill him. But his disciples, different group of disciples, took him by night and led him down through an opening in the wall, lowering him in a basket. So Damascus has a wall around it. So the only way out is through this wall, and that just shows his desperation to get away. I'll go over that wall. I don't care. I'll be lowered down in a basket. He was fleeing for his life. So imagine this, if you're fleeing for your life, where would you go? Would you not seek solitude? Would you not seek refuge with some friends and some family, somewhere where it's safe? So that was on Saul's mind. So he's going to look for some friends. But I want to share with you how the disciples responded to him. Let's go back to verse 26. And they were, so again, Saul comes to Jerusalem looking for refuge. He came, but the disciples were all afraid of him. They're all afraid of him. Now, can you blame him? Can you blame the disciples? So who was Saul? He was a persecutor of the church. He was actually a murderer. I want to go back to the beginning of chapter 9, verses 1 through 2. I'm going to read who he was. Saul, still breathing threats and murder. So again, murder, that is the action of killing. That is like a legitimate, like, I'm going to murder someone here. This is what Saul wanted to do. So threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. So anyone who was a follower of Christ, Saul was going after them. He went to the high priest and asked him for the letters to the synagogues at Damascus so that if he found any belonging to the way are the Christians. That's what they call them back then. The way, which were the Christians, men or women, he might bring them to bound them to Jerusalem. So what this text is saying here is he would go out, look for Christians, bind them together, and bring them to prison. What was the significance of that? Well, in prison is where they would be murdered. So actually, it wasn't Saul who would actually do the murdering, but he's the one that ordered it. It's kind of like a mob boss. You watch these movies. It's never the mob boss, the Don, who does the actual murder. But actually, he gets people to do it. But who would be guilty of murder? It'd be the mob boss, the Don. And so this is what Saul was guilty of. And if that wasn't enough, he was guilty of stoning Stephen. Now, Stephen was a good friend of the disciples. He was among them, and they would have him become a deacon. Now, imagine someone in your group that you're tight with, a group of friends, maybe 5, 6, or 7 people, and someone orders one of your friends to die. And this is what the disciples were understanding of who Saul was. Aren't you the guy who killed our friend? So really can't blame them. He had a past. It's kind of like a pit bull that you would see. You kind of like see it on the street. It's a good-looking dog. But you wouldn't get near it, would you? Because it's been stereotyped as someone that's ferocious. So as I see a pit bull, I'm like, oh, okay, cool, nice dog. I'll see you around. No, this one's been trained. He's not like those other dogs. Well, I don't know. It's a pit bull. It just looks nasty. I'm going to get away from it. I'm actually afraid. So here the tension continues between Saul and the disciples. More tension ensues. So I'm going to continue on in verse 26. So not only were they afraid, but they actually didn't believe that he was a disciple. You're not one of us. We're disciples, but you're not. Now imagine Saul, how he feels like, I can't win. I came from Damascus here, preaching the good news of Jesus Christ with boldness, and they're seeking to kill me. So I come to Jerusalem to seek refuge, and they reject me there. What's a man to do? Where am I going to go? So the tension ensues that they don't believe that Saul is a disciple. But here's where they mess up. Here's where the disciples make a mistake. Rather than looking at the fruit of Saul's life, they looked at his past. Now, I wonder how many of you have been judged for your past. Or how many of you are looking at other people and judging them for their past in the same way the disciples were looking at Saul. Because Saul's like, no, I am a disciple. So what were the fruits that Saul was bearing as a disciple? I made a list of 5 things, 5 marks of a reconciling faith. So this is fruit of salvation. So I'm going to name off these 5 things. So if you guys want to take notes of that, I regret that I don't have a slide for it. I wish I did, but I want to go through these 5 points with you. So just write these notes down along as I share them. So the first one is this, a changed life. Now we see a changed life in Saul. Totally, drastically different. He was once persecuting the church of Jesus Christ, and now he's going out proclaiming Jesus. No longer a persecutor, no longer a murderer, but a disciple of Jesus. And that was a radical change. So I want to go back to Ezekiel 36, 26 through 27. You don't have to go there, but I want to read this to you. It shows and demonstrates a changed life. This is what the gospel, it does. It changes us. Verse 26 says here, and I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. So here we have God saying to you, I'm going to give you a new heart. I'm going to give you a new spirit. I'm going to put my spirit within you. So tell me some, church, how can that be true, but yet someone's life isn't changed? Maybe you don't have a changed life because you haven't been given a new heart or a new spirit. Because when you get a new heart and you get a new spirit, how can there not be change? It's an indicator that the gospel has penetrated your life and you've been changed. You become a new creation. You're no longer the same person that you once were, but a new person than you were before. Number two, to profess or proclaim. That's exactly what Saul was doing. So he's like, no fruit? I'm not a disciple? Then what am I doing here? It's to be not ashamed of the gospel. Not to speak for Christ, but to proclaim. Thinking about proclaiming your faith. What does that look like? It means to do it publicly. To speak of Jesus Christ. Sort of like, so I met my wife 13 years ago. We've been married for 12 years. As soon as I met her, I was like, I can't wait to brag about her. I gotta tell people how beautiful she is. For those of you who know my wife, you guys are like, Mike, you definitely married up. Don't laugh so willingly there. It's true though. I wanted to brag about her. I couldn't shut up about how awesome she was. She's so smart, she's so brilliant, she's so funny, she's so amazing. But if I didn't talk about her in that way, if I didn't proclaim her, would she even think that we're in a relationship? So are we professing that we've been changed due to the gospel? And that's exactly what Saul was doing. I think a good example of that, proclaiming Jesus publicly, is through baptism. It's, I want to tell people who I am in Jesus Christ. I don't care what people think. In fact, I want them to know that I'm a disciple of Jesus. I'm a follower of Christ. This is who he is in my life. He's changed me. He saved me. And I need you guys all to know that because he can change and save you too. So it's to profess or proclaim. You know, I want to read a quote that John Piper shared in his Twitter. It says this. We're talking about words here because words are so important. We've heard it said that to preach the gospel, but if necessary, using words. You guys heard that before? But he goes on to say this. I'll read it from the beginning again. Preach the gospel. If necessary, use words. It's like saying, feed the poor, but if necessary, use food. Words matter. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So what's in your heart, you will speak. And if Jesus Christ had come into your life, has saved you and changed you and transformed you, then how can you keep that to yourself? How can you do such a thing? Number three, it's to testify. Write that down. It's to testify. It's giving evidence. It's like being a witness of what is true. It is sharing the gospel. How can somebody be changed and receive the good news of Jesus? Because that's the best thing that ever happened to a person. How can they not then share that? Have I ever told you that I won the lottery? No, I didn't. You know why I didn't tell you that? Because I didn't win the lottery. But here's my point. What do you do with good news? You share it. Maybe you're sitting here and you haven't shared the good news of Jesus Christ because you don't have it. In the same way that I never shared the good news that I won the lottery. By the way, I'm not saying you should do that. Please don't. 1 Timothy 6 has a lot to say about that. But my point is this. If you have the gospel, if you understand your depravity, and you understand that at one point you were separated from God, and then reconciled to him, that is good news. And what you do with good news is you share it. So that's the third thing that we see that Saul did to prove that he was actually a disciple of Jesus Christ. Number four, fellowship, love for others. Was he not going to Jerusalem for that reason, for fellowship? To have love for others, to desire community? You know, that's why I'm so hard on people to get in a small group, be a part of a community. I'm not saying you shouldn't have friends outside the church, but if that's your influence, they're not helping you to grow in your relationship with the Lord, I don't believe that that's your best. What your best is to be part of a community of other believers, and as a believer, you seek that. Like Trevor's BC days, I was very similar. If I saw a Christian come my way, I'm like, why would I want to hang out with that guy? He's so uptight, kind of nerdy, thinks he knows everything, thinks he's better than me, smarter than me. I've known many Christians in my past. I don't want nothing to do with them. But as I come to faith and been redeemed myself, I seek Christians. I want to have fellowship. I want to talk about the Lord together. I want to share how God's worked in our lives. I want to hear from you about what God's been doing in your life. I need encouragement. And to keep each other accountable, to have that biblical fellowship. Can I say what fellowship is not? It's not watching a Bears game together and not talking about the Lord and say, hey, I had great fellowship the other day with my small group. That was not fellowship. You hung out. That's awesome. But it wasn't true biblical fellowship. Increasing love for one another. And here's the fifth one, the last one. Increased love for God's word. Living in accordance to what God says. Increased obedience. Saul demonstrated that. All Jesus said was go. He put him on a mission. And he didn't even hesitate. He's like, great. He got knocked off the horse in Damascus. He picked himself up, and then he just continued on in Damascus. I'm not going anywhere else. I'm just going to share what God's done in my life. Right here, right now. He didn't wait. He was obedient to God's word. Jesus spoke, and he did it. So as you listen to this, I want you to examine yourself in the faith as I share this. If you find that these things don't apply to your life, can I share something in love? You haven't been reconciled to God. But see, that's what love does. I know that sounds a little hard, but what kind of pastor would I be if I didn't warn you about these things? In the same way, what kind of fireman would he or she be if they didn't warn you about fires? What kind of doctor would he or she be if they didn't warn you about cancer? So I'm sharing that in love. I hope you receive it that way. But we're challenged, we're encouraged to examine ourselves to see that we're in the faith. Are we a disciple of Jesus? Are we a follower of Jesus Christ? So the disciples would have just looked at Saul's fruit rather than his past. There wouldn't be this tension. The disciples thought that because of Saul's past, he had no future with them. You're not a part of us. We don't want you here. I just wonder, are there some people in your life that you're judging? Whether it's their social status, maybe they're outside of our church. Well, you don't go to Harvest. We can't hang out. I don't know about your theology. It's kind of whacked. You don't worship like we do. Maybe they're just an outsider in general. Maybe it's at school. Maybe it's at work. They're just a little different from you. Or maybe they just have a different color of skin. And they are judging you for it unfairly. But I wonder if you're doing the same. Because here's what the disciples did do. Because of Saul's past, they thought it was so bad. What could be worse than a murderer? So they kept him at bay. They wouldn't let him in. How could God forgive a person like that? Ever thought that way about someone? Ever looked at their life and like, there's no way they can be a Christian. Just look at them. When all along you have a log in your own eye. Or maybe you're thinking about your own past. You're sitting there and you're thinking to yourself, if only you knew where I've been. If only you knew what I've done. I don't want anyone to know my secrets. But I want to share something with you. That God knows your secrets. He sees it. He knows it. But it's our past that seems to be weighing us down. So I wonder what's weighing you down today. What are some sins in your life? What are some patterns that you have that you're unwilling just to release to the Lord? And it's not allowing you to move forward. Just sin weighing us down. But I want to share this with you too. God is much bigger than your past. Whatever sin that you have, God is much bigger than that. Because of God, since God saved Saul, could he not save you as well? Now I'm sitting looking at you guys thinking, I don't think anyone could be as bad as Saul in regards to that category of murder, but I don't know your past. So maybe you're thinking, could God even forgive me? But again, if he forgave Saul, why not you? There's a man by the name of David Berkowitz. Some of you may know him. If you don't, there's a picture of him. Back in the 1970s, he was also referred to as the Son of Sam. He went on a murder spree in the 70s in the streets of New York. Just through the summer, he killed 6 people for unknown reasons other than I heard voices from a dog, so I'm just going to go out and shoot people. He shot a total of 13, killing 6, injuring 7 others. So imagine what it was like to be in New York. No one wanted to leave their house. This guy's on the loose. He's out there and he's killing people. So of course he was caught, sent to prison. 10 years into being at prison, a random man who was never seen before walked up to him, said, "Hey, God loves you." And he gave him a Bible. And he says, "I don't want that." He's like, "Why not?" He's like, "Because why would a God love someone like me? Don't you know who I am?" So he kept it anyway. And someday, out of sheer boredom, he just opened up his Bible to Psalms 34. And it changed his life. It changed his perspective. And he understood, despite my past, God loves me and he wants me to be reconciled to him. And right then and there in his prison cell, he gave his life to Christ. He surrendered his life to Christ, asking for forgiveness, knowing that Jesus Christ paid the penalty for what he's done. All of it. Not just some of it, all of it. He needed a new life. Can't you see that didn't need a new life? He was in prison. He's going to be there forever. He needed some hope, and it only came through the gospel. Here's another guy, Jeffrey Dahmer, more modern, and he killed 17 people. Now, what kind of God would forgive this guy? How in the world can there be a God that would forgive what he's done? But here's what Jeffrey Dahmer did. He believed, according to 1 John 1:9, that if you confess your sins, God is faithful and just to forgive you. And that's exactly what Jeffrey Dahmer did. Unfortunately, he lost his life in prison. But would you believe this? He's in heaven right now, having a great day. But God, how can you forgive this guy? Who are you to stand before God between the cross and Jeffrey Dahmer and say, "God, you can't forgive this guy. Do you not know what he's guilty of?" God's like, "I'm so much bigger than that. I sent my son to die on the cross for him just like I did for you." Jesus' words in John 3:17, "I did not come to condemn the world, but to save it." That was Jesus' mission because he loves us. So David Berkowitz, Jeffrey Dahmer are forgiven. They humble themselves and have been reconciled to God. So what are you holding on to today and why? Maybe you don't know how to be forgiven. Well, just as I mentioned that Jeffrey Dahmer understood 1 John 1:9, that if you confess your sins to God, he is faithful and just to forgive. Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be what? Saved from what? Saved from your sin? Saved from the wrath of God? Saved from hell? While we were still yet sinners, Christ died for us. In my place, in your place, on the cross. Religion is not going to save you. Your good works aren't going to save you. In fact, Galatians 2:21 says this, I do not nullify the grace of God, for if justification came through the law, then Christ died for no purpose. If you think by being a good person gets you to heaven, then this was in vain. Jesus' death on the cross was therefore in vain. There was no purpose. No, thank you, Jesus. I can do my own good stuff. I can muster up my own good works. Therefore, I don't need you. That is an insult to the Lord. He says in the book of Isaiah, your works of righteousness are like filthy rags to me. It's an insult to think that you think you're good enough to get to heaven. But Jesus Christ says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. It's all about Jesus. Nothing about religion. Nothing about good works, good deeds. No man-made effort to make themselves right with God. But actually, Jesus is, he's the bridge. There's the gap between us and God. We need to be reconciled to God. And that's what Jesus Christ came to do. So if you're sitting here and you don't know if you've been forgiven, don't let today pass without you figuring that out. Get that settled once and for all. I'll be around after service. Let's talk. Because life is short. Eternity is for a very long time to get this one wrong. Let's have a discussion. We love you. But more so, God loves you. And he demonstrated that by sending Jesus Christ as a substitute for you. And that's what love does. So your past doesn't need to define who you are today, tomorrow, or forever. So back to the text, the narrative. Imagine how Saul is feeling. Is he feeling defeated? Is he feeling discouraged? Rejected? What is Saul thinking at this point? I can't win. I go to Damascus, spread the good news of Jesus, doing God's work. I flee because they want to kill me, and now I'm going back to Jerusalem where my friends are, but only have them reject me. But here's where it gets really good. Really, really good. It's kind of like thinking about a superhero movie. You guys like superhero movies? I picked on Pastor Ben last service. I asked that, and he's like, yep, right away. Didn't hesitate. I love superhero movies. Whatever your superhero is, think about it this way. It's like watching that movie. You ever notice they don't bring in the hero until like a third of the way into the movie? Because all this, like, it's getting built up here. The villain is out there. He's destroying the city. He's beating things up. He's killing people. He's messing things around. People are running. People are fleeing. They're like, help! Someone help us! They need a superhero. And this is exactly who we're going to introduce now. The unsung hero is Barnabas. Which brings me to my second point. Reconciling faith proclaims God's work in others, no matter the risk. Now remember, Saul is sought to be killed, and the disciples reject him. Let's start in verse 27 here. But Barnabas, now I want you guys to hear that in a way that brings a cheer to our congregation. Now the 9 o'clock service, they killed it. They were like screaming and hollering when I said, but Barnabas. So if you guys want to cheer when I say, but Barnabas, that'll help to bring some context in who Barnabas is, because he's the unsung hero. So let me read that again. But Barnabas, you guys did do better than 9 o'clock service. But Barnabas, just want to try that one more time. By the way, I love interaction at church. I love how you guys do that. I don't mind feedback. As long as there's no questions at the time, wait till after the service. But I love it. It fires me up. So we need to know, though, who is this superhero? Who is this unsung hero of Barnabas? Let me give you a little history. Acts chapter 4, 36 says that he is the son of encouragement. How would you like that for a name? Who are you known as? Well, I'm the son of encouragement. That's who I am. That's what I do. And he also sold a field to give to the poor. When's the last time that you sold anything to give to the poor? But that's who Barnabas was. Acts 11:24 says that he was a good man. He was full of the Holy Spirit and faith. He was just full of it. Just full of it. Barnabas was also an apostle. He was a mentor to Saul and John Mark. And the dude had some street credibility. I mean, when people saw him, they're like, that's Barnabas. If he says something, we're going to listen, all right? He was our unsung hero in this passage, but he didn't make it about himself. That's what unsung heroes do. They don't make it about themselves. There's something much bigger than just themselves. So let's pay close attention to what Barnabas does next. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared to them how on the road he had seen the Lord, who spoke to him, and how at Damascus he had preached boldly in the name of Jesus. So what Barnabas does is amazing. He sees the tension between the disciples and Saul, and he's like, I can't have that. There's something much bigger out there for us. Let's figure this out. So in the Greek, this is what Barnabas does. You can see there in the text. He took him, he brought him, and he declared to the disciples. Now in the Greek, this is amazing. Actually, what Barnabas does, he grabs Paul by the hand, and he brings him over, brings him to the disciples, like, hey, this here is Saul. He's a disciple of Jesus Christ. He's preaching the good news of Jesus Christ with boldness, and he loves God's people, and he's doing his work. He is a disciple, so he's proclaiming to disciples who he is, so don't mess with this guy. Thanks for holding my hand, Church Mike. You had a big job to do, and you did it well. So Barnabas takes action. He grabbed him, and he brought him. And the disciples dropped it just like that. What they did was they feared him, they hated him, but because of Barnabas, they became brothers. So why did Barnabas do this? Did it out of love. Barnabas is awesome. There's a quote from Bob Goff. He's a New York bestseller. He wrote the book, Love Does. And there's a quote that we found in the book. It says this: it will be people with the greatest love, not the most info, who will influence us to change the world. So Barnabas does what love does. It's an action. It's a choice. It's not based on feelings, but acts of obedience. You don't have to turn here, but I want to read from 1 Corinthians 13. I'm sure you guys heard this passage at many weddings. I would say out of like 10 weddings, 9 of them, 90% of them, always want to read from 1 Corinthians 13. But hey, no judgment here. You do what you want at your wedding. But it's so true, though, what love is. And I appreciate this when it is being read at a wedding. It starts with chapter 13, verse 4. This is what Barnabas is demonstrating. Love is patient and it's kind. How are you doing in that area of patience and kindness? That's what Barnabas was doing. Love does not envy or boast. So Barnabas, like Saul, had the gift to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. He's an evangelist. He could have said, who is this guy that's coming to do the work of the Lord when I want to do it too? I want to do the Lord's bidding. I want to be the guy. But yet he put himself aside because Saul was the one that was to be looked upon as the one that's going to bring the good news of Jesus Christ with boldness. It's not rude. It doesn't insist on its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoice in the truth, because love bears all things, and it hopes all things, and it believes all things, just as Barnabas did with Saul. So who do you need to be reconciled with? How are you being like Barnabas or not being like Barnabas? Maybe it's your spouse they need to be reconciled with. Maybe it's a family member or a friend or a coworker. Are you judging them in the same way that the disciples judged Saul? I want to move to 2 Corinthians 5:18. This is our obligation as Christians. 2 Corinthians 5:18 says, all this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Christians, we have a duty, we have a biblical obligation to bring reconciliation. We have an obligation and a duty as Christians to bring reconciliation. God chose us to be the ambassadors of Christ, so it is our duty for the sake of the gospel. Putting aside our preferences, insisting on our own way, and say, for the sake of the gospel, I'm going to go make it right with my brother or my sister over there. I have the good news. Perhaps they don't. But as far as it depends on me, I want to live peaceably among them all. So as we're called to that, this isn't like a suggestion or opinion, but rather we're called to it. As a Christian, if you are unwilling to reconcile with someone, you are hindering your ability to advance the gospel. It's like having a neighbor, my neighbor Mark, and if I have something against him, he against me. If I don't make it right with him, the gospel does not advance from me to him, that he would understand what forgiveness looks like. There's no grace. There's no love. So it actually would be hindered with me. So be reconciled. Why? For the sake of the gospel. It's so much bigger than you. So why did Barnabas, why did he do what he did? What was his motive? Yes, he did love Saul. Yes, he believed Saul. And yes, he advocated for Saul. But he did it for something much bigger than himself, which brings me to my final point. Point number three, reconciling faith releases God's work through others for multiplied fruit. For multiplied fruit. The results are in the hands of the Lord. All we are his instruments to be used by him. And this is exactly what Barnabas did. So look at the results of what Barnabas actually did. Through Barnabas' ministry, look what happens. So again, we're back in Acts chapter 9. And I'm going to read verses 28 through 31 for you. So follow along if you will. It says this. So he went in and out among them at Jerusalem, meaning like he was with the disciples. We're all good now. We're cool. He began preaching the gospel with boldness. So he was now being commissioned. He had confidence. And he spoke and disputed against the Hellenists. Hellenists were just a group of Jewish people who spoke Greek. Forget the root word there. But they were seeking to kill him. And when the brothers learned this, now they're calling them brothers. Before they were like enemies. I don't want anything to do with you. You got to keep away, but now we're considered brothers. You know what the awesome thing about brotherhood is? It gives you confidence. To know that your boy's got your back, that's awesome. Now you can move forward. I remember growing up playing basketball every day across the street from my house, weather permitting. And I was like 10 years old at the time. And at 10 years old, you kind of get pushed around a little bit by the older kids. And so I thought to myself, you know what's going to even the score? I'm going to bring my big brother with me. He was 5 years older than me. Now, when you're 10 and your brother's 15, that's a huge gap. That's a huge gap. He's so much bigger than me. So when I started playing basketball with my brother with me, guess what changed? My swag. Before I was like, oh no, here they come. They're gonna come get me. I'm just gonna hide behind the slides. But now with my big brother, I was like, what's up, man? You wanna play some ball? Give me the rock here. Everything changed, completely, entirely changed. I would look at them like, psh, you're nothing because I got my big brother with me. It gave me confidence. Just in the same way Saul now had confidence, it released him, it commissioned him to continue on in the work that the Lord called him to do. So the disciples had unity now. And because of Barnabas, the church was being built up. And when the brothers learned this, they brought him down to Caesarea and sent him off to Tarsus. So the church throughout all of Judea and Galilee and Samaria had peace and was being built up and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, it multiplied. So people are now walking in the fear of the Lord, walking upright, no more slouching, a healthy, good fear of the Lord, getting after it, building the church then multiplied. Are we all for church multiplication here at Harvest? We are, aren't we? Healthy things grow, don't they? But as a result of Barnabas's ministry, this is what took place. Now we can say, Mike, like if it isn't Barnabas, isn't it somebody else? God chose it this way for Barnabas to be that advocate. That through him, like us, the results could be fruitful ministry. It's not about us. It's all about Jesus. It's all about the gospel. So as a result of that, then we have something further. Paul goes on to write 13 books in the New Testament. Nearly 30% of the New Testament is Paul's writing. But can you imagine if he was stuck with that tension of the disciples? He wouldn't have been able to move on. He wouldn't have been able to move forward. But Barnabas, the unsung hero, said, nope, we're going to change that. So how many people did the gospel reach from Paul because of Barnabas? We're sitting here today because of that interaction. Because of that event that took place, Barnabas putting himself aside and saying, it's not about me. It's about the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's about reconciliation. All that and more. It can't be about me. So Barnabas' faithfulness brought that to fruition here today. All for what? For the sake of the advancement of the gospel. Here's how I'd like to close. The worship team wants to come up. I want to reiterate some things. Reconciling faith is our duty. Whether it's first with God. So if you're sitting here today and you don't know that you're reconciled with God, let today be something different for you. Let today be the day of salvation. Like, I came to church, listened to this message, I didn't think it applied to me, but after hearing the fruits of salvation, I realized I don't have that. Don't let today go by without you getting that settled once and for all. Reconciling faith to God. Number two, reconciling with one another. Spouse, family member, even your mailman. We're ambassadors of Jesus Christ. It's our duty to bring reconciliation so that the gospel will go out from us and to others so they can see our good works that would give glory to our Father who is in heaven. Or maybe you need to stand for someone. Maybe like Trevor, he's being treated unfairly. And you need to stand for him and say, no, that's not who he is. You've misjudged him. This is who he is in Christ. I need to advocate for him. Maybe someone in your life that you need to advocate for, someone who's hurt, go with them. Stick up for that person for the sake of the gospel. Because the gospel is so much bigger than you and I. So much bigger. And don't be the person to which the gospel will be hindered because of you. Let it flow from you. Let it flow out from you. Be a messenger of Jesus Christ to be a reconciler. Offer forgiveness. Ask for forgiveness. Make things right. Because if things are left undone or broken, it doesn't represent the cross. What represents the cross is reconciliation. Bringing it back to him, to which Jesus Christ would make you a new creation and having a relationship with him in the right way that would honor and glorify him. Let's pray. Father, we give you thanks for this morning and your message that we would be ministers of reconciliation, that we would have a reconciling faith like the apostles did, as Barnabas didn't count himself to be worthy of anything other than a servant of yours. He humbled himself and made things right. He grabbed the disciples, he grabbed Saul, and put them together as an advocate. And then they become family together, brothers now. And Lord, if there's anyone here who hasn't come to that decision that they would be reconciled with you, may today be the day of salvation for them. Or maybe it's a family member, someone in their life who has hurt them. May they go to them to risk it all for the sake of the gospel, because they're so much bigger than us. We love you, Father. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.